I must say, I'm glad I don't have to follow up that last presentation.
Well, I presented them to the Heartland Institute, but I also gave them my slides, and they hadn't turned up, so I've no idea, sir. No, it's not online, but I can. If people email me, then I'll send them a copy. But
that's
richardescourtney@aol.com.
We can take further questions along that line after. As I said, I'm glad I don't have to follow this up. That task falls to Andreas Prokop. I hope I pronounced your name correctly, yes, sir. He's an adjunct professor at the Department of Earth Sciences at the University of Ottawa, a position he has held since 2003. His areas of specialization include cyclostratigraphy, sedimentology, and the Cretaceous stratigraphy. He has held positions at the GFZ Potsdam, UC London, and the University of Ottawa. Since 2001, he has owned the consulting business SpeedStat, which specializes in research support, image and data analysis, computer modeling, and software development in earth and environmental science. Professor Prokop.
So thank you very much for the introduction. However, as you can see, I'm not an adjunct professor at the University of Ottawa anymore. I moved to Carleton University in the same city. So, but otherwise, everything is fine. Just to give you a little bit of background about this talk. So urban heat island effect is already widely published and well known since the mid-80s. It's not a new accomplishment to recognize that it exists. Even the IPCC Act knows about it and tried to adjust for it. But as Ross McKittrick mentioned, they adjust poorly for it. And I want to show you now where is the complexity in this adjustment of the heat urban island effect. And we choose Eastern Ontario, Canada, because there's a wide range of a really well-defined urban area and surrounded rural area, which can be used quite well for calibrations. Furthermore, the background of the study is also that the Canadian government in the late 90s published a study about the general climate trends in Canada based on their meteorological stations. Yesterday, you probably saw the talk from Timothy Ball, where he showed a little bit how the meteorological stations developed. Also, Ross McKittrick, I thought, he showed something like this. And that Canada, as a pretty new country, started having stations around the turn of the 19th century, and this slowly developed. Furthermore, Canada is challenged that there are not many settlements in the north, and that there were quite a lot of inconsistencies in running these stations, something what Ross McKittrick called a summary as homogeneity, which above shortage of staff maintaining stations, as well as calibration issues, and so on. I mean, Canada is a well-developed country, but still it faces these problems because it's such a huge area compared to a relatively low fiscal budget compared to the area. So anyway, this study was conducted 5 years ago, published 4 years ago, together with Tim Patterson from Carleton University. And yeah, now I'll start and give you a little bit of detail how this whole thing worked out. Okay. All right, so I just talked to you about the topic. Give you a little bit idea. Also, this area of Canada experienced long cold winters. This year it started with snow cover from mid-November, and we still have quite a lot of them. So usually we have about 5 months winter, also below sub-zero temperatures. Summer is quite short and hot, usually lasts from mid-June to the end of August. Then it gets a pretty nice fall. But in general, the spring is rather short, that's for sure. So what we use is the data temperature records from the Canadian monthly normals for 3 stations. Ottawa has several stations, but this is the longest running station and probably the best station because this one is very well maintained for a very long time. So the only, something what we saw in our pictures that for maybe pavement is around or trees growing around. This has been very well taken care of. So what we have here as extra effect would be just the urban growth. And the data provided are by the Canadian Atmospheric Environment Service. So the data are corrected for instrumental errors. So the data by themselves are now clean, except that we are not corrected for urban island effects. Coming to the next point, we'll see a little bit about the stations. So there are quite a lot of stations in eastern Ontario. If we would go to the left, more in the west, there would be even more stations. So the three main stations are highlighted. Montreal, also as a big urban center, has also a long-running station, but we had, unfortunately, a few years where we didn't have any good calibrated records, which were taken out of a record. So for this kind of analysis, it's not very useful. All the other stations you have the same problem as also Maniwaki, which I will show. The thing is that only Morrisburg and Ottawa stations, which are run for more than 80 years, Ottawa for over 100 years, Morrisburg for 80-something years. The other stations started more or less after the Second World War to run, but in a financial of doing some fiscal problems which the government experienced in the mid-90s, things had to be recalibrated for the staff shortage, so we couldn't run anything. So it's not cherry picking that I selected here the Maniwaki station, which looks terribly short. It's a record only from 1954 to 1994. But this is the longest available record outside Ottawa and Morrisburg. And this is in many, many places in Canada. Also it's probably at this time in the mid-90s, there were only 20% of well-calibrated stations left. This improved afterwards again. Yeah, now we are high in the network again, but these data are kind of lost fiber for this kind of analysis. So what we see here are the wide variations of summer and winter, all these up and downs, what you will see are the summer-winter differences, which are pretty high. So it goes average temperature in the winter, January, February, is about minus 7 degrees daily average. In the summer high is about plus 26 in average. And what you can see, in general, it's the same pattern overall. If you just look at the data, you only see this annual fluctuation, nothing else. In between is the running average, annual average. So basically, you see really the mean. And it's also a pretty small flicker curve by itself. If you just look at them, it doesn't say too much. I put the gradients in. I don't even put on the side for this interval, which we really can compare, where we have three stations parallel running. And what you see here is that Ottawa has a gradient of 0.098, just to make it per year. This would be about 1 degree per 100 here from a gradient, if you extrapolate it. The same thing, it would be about minus 1 degree for Morrisburg and minus 0.6% for Maniwaki. So why is this difference? I just want to, also this interval is not an interval which is characterized by this continuous trend. What's actually, if you look at the global curve, the interval before and the interval afterwards has experienced more warming than this interval in average. However, this interval is what we have, and it is important to the relative comparison, not the absolute comparison. So I don't want to emphasize here that it's got really cooler at this interval. I just want to emphasize that Ottawa is distinctively different from the others. Now, one problem is to ask the question here, okay, it looks like linear difference. Is it really linear? The problem is when you correct for heat urban island effect, it's normally done by populations. To calculate the population, but how exact have to know the population? Because it doesn't start with five people at the beginning starting a settlement and then goes gradually up to 1 million. So you have to have pretty exact data to correct for this. And realistically, the census data, when really collect how many people live in a place, and even much other things are not so well collected. Coming to the next picture, to do this kind of analysis, we go away from a pure, strictly linear trend, what we show in so many courses, but going a little bit more complex types of data analysis, in particular time series analysis, which you can see here. Also trend and regression analysis is basically what we saw so often here, and which is very commonly used and very good method. But we go a step further, use wavelet analysis, cross-spectral and spectral analysis, which give you an idea about the cyclic structure and the temporal structure, how things change temporally in it. And we want to see how this compares between the different stations. Okay, so this is the first, the departure of the mantle temperature from rural area. What it basically is, it just make a difference of Ottawa station minus Morrisburg station. So just how see how this gradual change, and as you can see, I mean, this is a R square, which gives you a measurement for the quality of the correlation, looks quite low, but you have a huge amount of data, so even this low R square is significant. And what you can see in both cases, the first one, the values are here. Push the blue button.
No, out here. Try it. Okay. No, just press it. Try that.
No, that's fine. Not, I don't want to go forward. I just want to highlight.
Sorry.
So, okay, we'll good. No, it's fine. No, I'm on the right spot now. Thank you very much. So anyway, what you can see, there is a trend that the temperature departure increases. Now again, put a black line in with a linear gradient, but if you see, it's ups and downs, ups and downs above the line. There's a pretty high variance between when you're in such a year, for example, now it's really bad. Anyway, if you look about around this spike down around 1972, you see, for example, that it appears to be that Ottawa was much cooler than Morrisburg, which probably happened. Also, climate and is, of course, a very difficult field, and the whole circulation pattern is different. In general, the similarity between in this area between the stations, also basically the temperature is quite stable, but it still can change locally. If there are some freaky weather which happens, snowstorm covers only one area, not the others. And so you can have a quite strong annual difference despite the fact. First, thank you very much. Okay, try this one. Now I won with pointer.
You just want a pointer?
Yeah, no, I can combine this now. I have two hands. That's perfect. So now we see the look in a little bit in detail. So there are various ways to look at it. One way is to look at it on a long-term trend, to this I come later. And our thing is to go more to the very high fluctuation. This is the annual change. The change between winter and summer temperature. And what you can see here is, so Ottawa is a red line. At the beginning, because you can only compare to Morrisburg, Ottawa had a much stronger annual amplitude, as it means a summer-winter difference, to make it, to simplify it. It's about, also Ottawa had about 23 degrees, and Morrisburg was about 21 degrees. It changes over the time, each year's difference, but in general, at the beginning, Ottawa was always higher difference, and then it goes down and down and down and down, and at the end, it was only slightly higher or not even higher. Compared to Maniwaki, it's approximately the same. However, I go a little bit more in, you can't really see here. Okay, zoom a little bit in this comparable area. Now, unfortunately, switch the colors a little bit. Now you can see, as Ottawa started off in around 1954 with the highest annual amplitude, and it went down and down and down relatively to the hours, and then it ended up about 1.5 degree below the average for Maniwaki before it was about 1 degree higher than Maniwaki. There is some variability in it, but the same thing comparable to Morrisburg. Again, it comes now really close to the, often here to the Morrisburg stations, where at the beginning it was a pretty large contrast. So what it says is that if the annual temperature difference decreases, you can either have colder summers and the winter stays the same, or you have warmer winters and summer stays the same. Considering that we already know that the average temperature in Ottawa increased compared to Java, so we cannot say that there is any decrease involved in a temperature decrease involved, but it is an increase in Ottawa. The reason why we have this decrease must be that annual temperature range in Ottawa decreased due to a winter warming. So the winters got significantly warmer. Yeah, because more house heating, more traffic, and feels heat all radiates around the city and gives a bloom. Just even if you come here to New York, fly in from New York, just 10 kilometers outside of New York, you have the same effect. There's still a lot of snow, you come here, everything is gone. Basically the same effect. The thing is, also this is well known, but it's a quantification here, that it's quite a big percentage, that's basically the winter temperature approximately dropped from about 1%. So basically everything in Three Seed Island effect is related to the change in the winter warming, actually, in Ottawa. Okay, now coming to the annual temperature difference, how this actually the annual temperature amplitude difference, when you also see that original Ottawa had a much higher fluctuation in the annual temperature and compared to Morrisburg, but this smoothed out also compared to Maniwagon smoothed out. So at first Ottawa had much more summer winter contrast and ended up to have the same. Okay, Maniwagon, Ottawa is a little bit weak, the data is a little bit short, and the 4-year moving average is not very decisive, but from Morrisburg it's well to see. But what you also can see, it much more happened at the first half of the last century than in the second half. Things became already quite settled around 1960. So when I had this short interval, what I showed you about the changes, it was not even the strongest case scenario. It's probably more a heat island effect happened already in the beginning. It's just comparable to Morrisburg. Now we have to see Morrisburg settlement is less than 20,000 people, around 15,000 I think at the moment, and Maniwagon even less, it's just 1,500 people who live there. So it's there was no significant growth. So coming now after to wavelet analysis, this method can show you how pattern like cycles can change over time. Also you can have sometimes, for example, some slight indication like here 12 here. This is also the length of a cycle over time of this temperature record. You have maybe a weak indication of a 12-year cycle, and then for a long time you don't have any indication. For you can really see when you have it more and when you have it less. Then you have a lot of higher frequency, which can be partially El Nino, partially it's noise. Interesting thing, that these patterns really happen in all sections, very parallel, very similar, approximately the same wavelengths. So what it indicates, when we have these heat island changes, it is because we are so similar between the places, it does not happen on a time scale between 1.5 and about 50 years. Here, we can't go forward with Morrisburg anyway. With Maniwagon, with Morrisburg, you see when there's some indication that there are some differences in a long-range spectrum. I must say the linear trend has been removed before. This would give you, in all cases, a line, which we had already before, so with a regression line. But anyway, this higher frequency pattern, 1.5 to about 20 years, doesn't contribute anything to the difference between the different stations. So it's a longer one. So looking here in cross-spectral analysis, it's also a method where you can see how these cycles over the whole time interval in average relate to each other. I don't want to, this is a so-called spectral analysis, the power spectrum. Clearly the 1-year signal dominates everything, so everything else looks more or less like noise, which is probably is considering over a long time interval. Nothing is really possible to forecast very well. Most important is this part. When you see the offset in the phase between, as it means how how you, if you try to correlate special cycles, you have, for example, the sunspot cycle, how it shows up in one record, and to the other record, if we really overlap each other. If you have in phase shift, we don't overlap each other. We're out of phase, as we call. So most of the things are annual cycle, of course, perfectly in phase at one. What's out of phase is really the long record. 6 years already a little bit short. Actually, it's really the really long 20 and longer years. We're at out of phase. Well, really, there's something different in the temperature pattern between the different stages, also between Ottawa and the other two. And so we have to see now what is really the reason for it. It's a relatively long-term pattern. Also, when we say about term alpha, it was not that we had a short-term growth which changed the regression line and it went back. It was really a long-term. So actually, regression line is probably an appropriate approach to it. Now looking here to this pattern. Now, what this shows you is how the population growth is. Now, as I mentioned, in many other places, North America, probably also Europe and everywhere in the world, measurement of the population size, basically census data, were collected, are not so regular. At the beginning, it was about each 10 years in Ottawa that we counted how many people really live in Ottawa. Yeah, later on, it got more frequent. It's about, sometimes here it was each second year when it started, a 5 year difference. So it gets a little bit uneven after 1980. We have a little bit more data. But what we see here is this would be if dotted line would be if it would be a constant population growth. So it's not, it was above average at the beginning, below average here, somewhere in the 20s to the 40s, then about average and really strong again in the end of the 80s to the end 90s. Now this is also POP is population multiplied by 100, so we have, at this point we ended up at about 400,000, here it was about 500,000, now Ottawa has about 700,000 inhabitants and the metropolitan area of 1 million. So what we see, again, this was one of the early graphs, so to show here's the regression line, but what we see in detail is how that sometimes we're clearly above the regression line and sometimes clearly below. And here, this is a part where really Ottawa, the temperature difference is much more than linear. And this is exactly the time when we had a rapid population growth. Here the population accelerated to growth, in its growth. Same thing it was in the beginning of the 1960s, a big housing and growth also around the area. I have to see that in Ottawa, I live in Ottawa, so I know a little bit about how everything, basically how the city is organized, that the station has around a kind of so-called experimental farm, a kind of farmland, not highly built buildings. So there is some effect which comes from the outer areas, from the suburban areas, which were really strongly built at this time in the war. And another housing boom was around in the late 80s, 1990s. Before the housing market collapsed and not so many people moved for a while into Ottawa. So these spikes here show up in the relative differences between Ottawa very well. And this makes it so complicated to correct for the heat or mileage effect, because this now, we know now, we have stations which we can use to calibrate here in Ottawa. Our places of the world, it does not necessarily exist. Nothing is in the vicinity of a big city which has a really long record which can be used to calibrate the record. Also, you have to have some kind of measurement of the strengths. When I think Carl was it in 1988 published his paper about really a quantification of heat-urban-islet effect, he mentioned, as you got off a quantification out, but it's very difficult to get the data to come up. Now we in Ottawa, we can recalibrate this, but in most places it's not possible. So basically what, to conclude, so the temperature in Ottawa increased an average in a rate of 0.1 degrees Celsius per year or 1 degree per 100 year over last century. We can know now from wavelet analysis that this is a pretty, this is really related to the population growth, altogether somewhat gradual, also can be really compared to population growth, which is relatively gradual with some exceptions. And island rent has some multi-decadal and interseasonal cycles, which also increase to the gradual increased winter heating, heat islands effect compared to the population growth. So thank you very much.